6 years ago, I joined the Peace Corps. And I was eventually placed in a small village in Costa Rica, only 7 kilometers from the Nicaraguan border to the north. There were roughly 300 residents in my town, and almost all of them were illegal Nicaraguan immigrants. Roughly 60% of the town was unemployed, and only 6% had graduated from high school, so fewer than 20 people. The majority of the town was living on what the United Nations defines as extreme poverty, which means that they had less than $2 a day to feed their families. I rented a room from a family with a small farm. There was no running water or electricity. And being that we were in the jungle, daily temperatures would rise above 100 degrees every day when the sun was at its peak. Sometimes 3 or 4 times a day, I would pull up water from a well that was built into the kitchen, stand in the cement basin, and simply pour it over my head with a pail just to cool down. First light around the equator is a fairly consistent thing around 5 o'clock every morning, and I had a routine. I would wake up around 4:45 and pull my first bath. And then, still wet, I would sit on a cement slab of a porch and enjoy the cool morning temperatures before the heat came. Around 5:15, the family I was living with would stir, and within moments, I would have a steaming hot cup of coffee. It was instant coffee, which is an odd thing in Costa Rica, but it's true because all of the good stuff is imported for us. So poor Costa Ricans tend to drink instant coffee, which ironically is imported oftentimes from the United States. Every day at about the time I got my coffee, a man named Lorenzo would emerge from the orange groves around the house. And he would stride across the field and talk to Tito, the owner of the farm, who would point him in some direction, and he would set off to cut the grass with his machete. Gas is expensive, and so are machines, so he would bend low over the earth, and with his left hand, he would pull up the grass, and using the machete as a scythe, he would chop the grass with his right. While Lorenzo did this, Tito and I would milk the cow and several of the goats on his farm, and we would set aside 1 cup of goat's milk and a used Coca-Cola bottle. And we would set that bottle on a windowsill for Lorenzo to pick up after he was done. Lorenzo worked for about 5 hours every day. Brutal, literally back-breaking work. And his only reward was his 1 cup of goat's milk. I used to share that story with my high school Spanish students when they would complain about studying for a quiz. A little perspective can make the whole world look different. Remember that, because I'll return to it in a moment. Today we heard 2 miracle stories from the Gospel of Mark. And as usual, Mark places these stories side by side in order to draw our attention to how they exist in relationship with each other. In both stories, we hear people begging Jesus to heal someone else. But in the first story, Jesus seems unwilling, even indignant. In fact, when the Syrophoenician woman approaches him and asks him to heal her daughter, Jesus essentially tells her that she is a dog and that she should get in line. By way of contrast, when the Sidonians bring a deaf and mute man to Jesus in the second story, he gives way immediately, sighing and healing the man. So what's the difference? Why does Jesus react so harshly to the woman and not to the Sidonians presenting the deaf man? As with most things in the Bible, a lot has been written and commented on about this particular passage, and it's not uncommon to hear it said, and this isn't entirely incorrect, that this is an example of Jesus' humanity, where he was short-tempered, perhaps even prejudiced, in a way that all of us humans are. But I think that Mark might be trying to see something a little bit more in this comparison. I want to suggest this morning that Mark is trying to underscore the nature of our relationship with Jesus by drawing a distinction between the way these people approach Jesus. In our New Revised Standard Version in English today, we heard that both the woman and the Sidonians used the same verb. They begged Jesus to help. But in the original Greek, two different verbs are used, and they suggest that the two requests are made quite differently. The verb used by the Syrophoenician woman, eroteo, suggests a request from a preferred position, a request that should receive special consideration because of a special relationship. Edwin Abbott, an English classicist, defines this verb as to ask on special footing. By way of contrast, the verb used to describe the Sidonian's request, parakalousin, is strikingly humble. The verb is a compound verb that literally means they are beside calling, para, to be beside kalousin, calling. This isn't even the normal verb to ask in Greek. It's an odd construction that might be more artfully translated to pleading or entreating. It doesn't have any sense of entitlement, only genuine need. And so the key difference between these two requests is humility. Mark's description of the Syrophoenician woman request suggests that she's badgering Jesus. It says in the text that he cannot escape. And it also implies that she seems to think that she deserves a miracle. And as we heard, it is not until this woman has humbled herself before Jesus that she is able to receive his grace. Jesus implies that she is a dog, and she replies to Jesus, chastened, "Sir, even the dogs under the table eat the children's crumbs." And it's here that Jesus in Mark's gospel makes the point very clear. He says, "For saying that, the demon has left your daughter." In other words, it is only once the Syrophoenician woman has humbled herself and given up her misconceptions about what she does and does not deserve that she is able to receive God's grace. And this is a good reminder for all of us. What in our lives do we think that we deserve? Good health? An average lifespan? I've always thought 85 sounded nice, but I'm pretty far from it. How about minimum wage and health benefits? 2.5 kids, a minivan, and a Labrador retriever, to pick the most common American attributes. Most of us, if not all of us, think that we deserve something, even if only by our unspoken assumptions about how our life will go. The funny thing is that these assumptions oftentimes keep us from realizing how lucky we are to have the things that we do have. A good example of this has been the Occupy Wall Street movement of the past few years. Most of the people in the Occupy movement are actually a part of the 1% without realizing it. When we think on a global scale, a full 50% of Americans are a part of the elite 1% earners. In fact, if you make $34,000 a year, you are securely and firmly in the 1%. And so if you didn't know that, and you've always wanted to be rich, today's your day. You're it. We are the 1%. Again, a little perspective can make the whole world look different. Mark trying to reveal to us a really hard truth. And that is that we don't deserve anything when it comes to our relationship with God. Nobody here signed a contract with God before we were brought into this life. And as a result, we don't get to sue God for breach of contract when things don't turn out as we think they should. When it comes to God, the former Brutonian Thomas Jefferson just got it wrong. We don't have certain inalienable rights. Lorenzo, who worked for 5 hours a day for one cup of goat's milk, was one of the happiest men that I have known. Not because he lived a comfortable or easy life, on the contrary, but because every day before setting to his task, he said a prayer of thanksgiving that he was alive to feed his infant child. I heard him do this every day before setting to work. You see, a funny thing happens to those of us who are able to let go of a sense of deserving something. We might even call it a miracle. Because when we stop being unhappy and expectant about those things that we don't have, space is created to be happy and fulfilled with the things that we do have. Gratitude replaces expectation. To say the same thing in a different way, the moment that we start to think that we deserve something from this life is the moment that we catch a spiritual cold, a sickness. No matter what our situation is, rich or poor, Syrophoenician or Sidonian, black or white, male or female, Greek or Jew, we have been given a gift in the form of what poet Mary Oliver calls this one wild and precious life. Mark tells us that we don't have a contract. We don't have any rights. We do have an unearned gift known as life. And both the gift of life itself and the grace to understand it as such are the products of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. But Mark reminds us today that our faith in Christ is not something that allows us to approach Jesus from a privileged position, like the Syrophoenician woman. On the contrary, like the Sidonians, it is our faith in a God who accepts suffering and death on our behalf that compels us to a life of gratitude and humility. And this is where miracles are possible. A miracle such that even an illiterate, poverty-stricken man who works 5 hours a day for a cup of milk to feed his infant child, whose mother died in childbirth, can be content and give thanks to his God every day. I pray that each one of us might daily have our ears open and our tongues loose to spread this good news to the world. Ephesus.